kind of combination of things, including volcanic CO2. We have done, if you know the pH independent from the data on the carbonate, you can play better games with the amount of carbon released. Because if you want to interpret the carbon isotopic excursions in terms of total amount of carbon released, you must know the isotopic composition of the released carbon. And if you take methane hydrates with an isotopic composition of, say, minus 60, you need to release much less than if you release organic carbon with an isotopic composition of minus 25. And then you can play, as people have done, a number of interesting games, because you say, the isotopic composition is minus 60. How many gigatons do I need to produce this carbon isotopic excursion? But that same amount of gigatons must then explain the amount of dissolution you see in the deep sea and the amount of global warming that you see. And those things never quite fit. That was always really kind of difficult to do. And that was particularly difficult to do because, as I said, you need to know the isotopic composition of the stuff you release to get some idea about what happened. If you were to know the pH, then that constrains what you do with the amount of carbon. And so if we now think that we can use the boron data to know the pH, then we can step back and we can argue that we know the amount and isotopic composition of the carbon. And if you do that, then we come up with a value that is too heavy to be purely gas hydrate. But this is not yet published, so maybe it's not true. As we argue, we want quite a lot of volcanic CO2 with some addition of something lighter, which may be either organic or it may be methane hydrates.
How about this? So there's unfortunately, we hear in the Gulf of Mexico back in the surprise of 2010.
Uh-huh.
There was a large, obviously, oil well plant.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Connected to a reservoir.
Yes.
Uh-huh. That is a large oil gas reservoir releases mm-hmm. from the subsurface mm-hmm. to tectonic activity. Mm-hmm. Release both methane mm-hmm. and CO2.
Mm-hmm.
And we know that benthic systems are very, very severely affected by this.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not only mm-hmm. because of acidification, but it's also because of toxicity.
Uh-huh.
And so you get the acidity, but you also have the toxicity,
right,
which could give you, obviously, a pretty severe dose of
death. Right. I have two answers. No one ever has a new idea. There is a version of this on the market. And this version... But no, it's different. Because you may have heard of the lakes in Africa, Lake Nyos and Lake Manoun. In which you have volcanic CO2 leak into a lake. And, you know, as long as you have something that doesn't turn over, the actual solubility of CO2 in water is very high, so you can stuff almost a limited amount of CO2 in the bottom waters of a lake as long as it doesn't go out to the atmosphere. And so in the tropics where you don't have seasonal temperature changes, what you do is you build up huge amounts of CO2 in the lower waters of a lake. And the CO2 is partially used by microbes and changed into CH4 and all kinds of things. And then if you have the accident of having some tectonic activity or a big landslide, then it all comes out. And it kills a lot of people and cows in the area. And so people have argued that you have the Arctic Ocean that by that time is kind of lakeish. And you have a large basin in the North Sea called Kilda Basin. And you have North Atlantic volcanism. And you have in Canada a number of diamond mines in diatremes that supposedly had CO2-rich magma. And so you can build up the CO2 in the North Atlantic or the Arctic Ocean as a mega Lake Nyos. And then you do something tectonic or volcanic, and out it all comes. So that is one way of taking the slower emission rates from volcanic provinces and translating them in a very rapid process. I haven't heard anyone about, you know, some version of drilling and things. The nauseous is
Oh, sure.
Oh, I'm sure there are. We haven't thought of all of them. However, if our latest story is right, then organic matter, whether oil or gas, is still going to be too light, and we need to mix in some volcanic stuff to come up with the right isotopic composition. But
you got methane in oil.
What? No, but so we still say if we have methane in oil, it's too light. So we need to mix in some CO2 that is isotopically heavier than that. And so there's indeed a whole literature on ocean eruptions that have to do with bubbling things.
Yeah. You talked a lot about carbon dioxide, but I was wondering what the oxygen concentrations were, and if you have anoxia, can it lead to some extinction?
Yes, but so I think that in the open ocean we did not have major scale anoxia on any of the proxies that I've seen. However, as I mentioned when I talked about the minerals, that is maybe only because the record is not good enough. Because if you have, even if you have totally anoxic conditions and you form, say, black shales with organic matter, then if the system turns toxic again, that organic matter may oxidize, and you don't see it anymore in the record. And we know that, for instance, from the Mediterranean, where we had organic rich layers, and in some of them now again, all that organic material has disappeared, and even the geochemical content has disappeared. And so, on the evidence we had, I would argue that the intermediate waters, never the deep waters, the intermediate of the waters of the ocean did not go fully anoxic, but it is true that the evidence may not be good enough. And if we assume a period of anoxia that was short on the geological time scale, say between 100 and several thousand years, then we may not see it with the records that we have.
One more.
What?
Spatial variability.
Well, kind of yes and no. Until now, the amount of dissolution on the seafloor is, you know, I mean, you expect, of course, a depth effect, right? But so in some places in the Southeast Atlantic, we know that the calcium carbonate compensation depths went shallower by more than 2 kilometers. Because we have sites that were different in depth by more than 2 kilometers. And there was calcium carbonate deposited at the deepest site before and after. And there was no calcium carbonate deposited at the shallowest site during the PTM. And so at that location, the calcium carbonate compensation depth must have moved up by more than 2 kilometers. At other sites, it is much less. And you can deal with that by looking at the way in which the ocean circulates and things like that. But the sites where we originally discovered the PETM in the Southern Ocean have, on all everyone's models, have insufficient dissolution. So there definitely is spatial variability. And some of that we can explain by direction of ocean circulation and just remineralization of organic matter, etc. But that cannot, at the moment, explain the full variability that we see spatially. Well, that also we can model and think about. Because, of course, what with high latitude surface temperatures of about 10 degrees, the overall temperature gradients were much less than today. And so there have been people who argued that indeed, as we're talking about when we mentioned the eddies, there are people who have argued that at a time of so much less temperature differences, you have much more vertical mixing than we have today because of less overall density differences and more effect of vertical mixing through some kind of eddy system, which I don't know enough about. Well, we know something about the direction of circulation, again, that we derive from carbon isotopes. Because as water is out of contact with the atmosphere for longer, it will collect more organic matter that gets oxidized, and you will see a change in the carbon isotopic composition. And so at the moment, for instance, there's an offset of more than a per mil between the Atlantic and the Pacific deep water. And so if you have enough patterns of that, you can have some constraints on what water was moving. However, we never know anything about the water that has no carbonate in it, and so we never know anything about the true bottom waters in the ocean basins.
I'd like to be honest. Thank Ellen again.